how many young boys do you think you had fun with?
Oh. Well, there's an old saying, as many dicks they were put in me, if they were sticking out, I'd look like a porcupine. That's how many.
Yeah, it's pretty gruesome. I kind of have an issue with how that question was posed, though. Like, have fun with young boys, because it kind of undermines it. Like, I understand he's trying to relate to his guest, but it sounds like he is enabling it. So that's not good. Anyways, here we go.
All right, Frankie.
Yes, sir.
Frankie, where'd you grow up? Where are you from originally?
Cleveland, Ohio.
And tell me about your childhood. You had both of your parents when you were young?
Yes.
How would you describe your childhood?
Exciting for a person who knew he was gay at the age of 11 or 12 in a time when it wasn't right. And I had a, let's start the story. I had a mother who had a boyfriend while my father was alive. But I don't think my father cared because he was like 24 years older than my mother. When my mother used to go with her boyfriend, I used to lay next to her while he was having sex with my mother. And I quite didn't know what all that was about until I got older and started hearing sounds that I heard when I was a kid. Then when I got older, about 11 or 12, I started paying for guys in my school, $5 here, $8 there.
Okay. This is already starting off bad because the guy is saying that his father basically used his mother as a sex object because she was 24 years younger than him. And then it sounds like his mother was a narcissist because she's having sex right near her child and doesn't care about him, doesn't have any awareness of that. This is already like really downhill start.
And one of the guys told on me, and I think I was the very first sex offender to ever be arrested for that. Matter of fact, I'll never forget it, a black judge, her last name was Kennedy. This is in Cleveland, Ohio.
I don't know what her being a black judge has anything to do with.
Cleveland Press and the Cleveland Plain Dealer. I'm sure if you looked in the archives, I'd be there.
I mean, it already kind of sounds like he's glorifying it a bit, saying like, oh, I was the very first sex offender and I'm in the archives. Like, you know, he probably wasn't, but anyways, people have been committing sex offenses for a really long time. So here we go.
Anyway, judge gave me a year probation. I had to spend two summers on an Amish farm.
That's a nice judge.
That was my sentence. And I think I was 11 or 12. And then nothing happened until I got into my 30s. And a hustler came up to me and he was like 16 years old. And I paid it and I paid the price. I did 5 years house arrest.
Wait, so is he a hustler or was he an undercover cop? Because it sounds like he's an undercover cop. But you can already hear this guy making himself a victim. Here we go.
And all that good stuff. A group and everything. And then about 4 or 5 in 2003, I picked up a gentleman. I came home from the bar a little drunk. He was 13. I guess I really wasn't looking at age. I didn't ask how old he was. Took him home. Well, there was a whole thing before that. He lied to me. He told me that he was waiting for his brother to pick him up from Tarpon Springs.
You see what he's doing here? He's already blaming it on the child. But also, I mean, 13... it's kind of hard to disguise 13. If he had said 16 or 17, that could happen. But yeah, anyways, he's lying.
This and that. And so I took him home. I said, well, why don't you stay at my place? One thing led to another, dirty movie, and then sex. Then I found out the next day when he knocked on my door after school that he told me, if you don't buy me a carton of cigarettes, I'm going to tell. And I said, tell what? He said, I'm 13 years old. So for weeks, I bought him a carton of cigarettes every week till finally I ain't doing this anymore. So a couple months later, I got arrested for that.
And all right, you could tell he's leaving a lot out of that story, but again, he's making himself into the victim. He's making the child sound like the child was bad. I don't think there are very many 13-year-olds who go into a situation like that trying to manipulate and hustle an adult. That seems a bit presumptuous. Like, I just don't see a 13-year-old doing that. Maybe a 17-year-old, yeah, 16, 15, 13. I mean, and it's a carton of cigarettes to prevent a major felony. Something about that whole thing obviously is off. Anyways, but let's keep going.
I spent 8.5 years in prison. I'm not going to say I learned my lesson, because everybody says they learned their lesson.
Lucy's honest there.
I know I'm not going to do that again. I'm 74 years old. My sex life is over with. I have no feelings for that anymore with anybody. I just want to live my life out and have no more of this hell. Because if you go up,
he's once again making himself the victim. He's like, I don't want any more of this hell. Like, I'm not, like, he the whole time he's been a victim. But yeah, I'm not buying the whole I'm 74, I don't have those thoughts anymore thing.
Out there and do something that you shouldn't do with an underage person, it is hell afterwards. They say, well, I've done my time. No, you haven't done your time. Your time starts after you get out of prison. That's when your time starts.
And what do you mean by that?
When I'm in a store, if a kid comes up to me, I shy away.
Okay.
I shy away because it just makes me shy away.
Shy.
It scares me to death. You never know who's watching you. And I just shy away. I won't let myself be in that position. I don't think about it, you know, when a kid comes up to me, it just like throws a red flag out. They tell you when you go to group about the red flags. So it just throws up a red flag. So I just, if he says hi to me, I gone.
What?
But life is very hard.
I mean, is that a bad thing though? I mean,
hard.
He's not supposed to be near kids anyways. He's a sex offender. So, I mean, that's his job, is to say hi as he's walking away.
When you're banished as a sex offender, or even harder, as a sex predator, because once that happens, you go in a neighborhood and they tell everybody on that street that they have a sex offender living there.
That's what they're supposed to
do. You go into an apartment building, they tell everybody in the apartment building that there's a sex predator living there. So you're never away from it. I have to register 4 times a year with the sheriff's department. And that's no fun, because if you forget, you go back to prison and you got to do your sentence all over again.
I mean, he's already said it was more boys basically than he can count. So the fact that he's even out right now is crazy, yet he's complaining again and playing victim because he has to show up 4 times a year. All right, anyways, let's keep going. I'm trying not to be too critical on this. I'm not, yeah.
Your whole complete sentence. So it's really bad to do a crime. And especially when a murderer is not treated like a sex offender is treated. And it's, to me, that's just not right. But to the world, it is.
He's big time.
And think my mother sort of screwed my life up because of the things that happened while I was laying there. And when my uncle, supposedly Uncle Joe, who she was messing with, would spend the night at our house, I'd get up in the middle of the night and try to make it with him in the bed. I mean, that's all I knew. I thought that was normal.
So you would initiate?
Yeah, but he pushed me away. Nothing ever happened. He never told my mother. But that's what would happen when he came over.
And you were how old?
I was 6 or 7. About that age. He was a custodian. And he had a room with the, that's where he lived. He had a room down there with the big boilers. It was a big building he was custodian in. I'd say it was about 7 or 8 stories, big, big building. And there were boilers there. And my mother, that's where she would go and have sex with him. And it was a small bed, it wasn't a big bed. And I'd be laying right next to my mother. And they would do the deed. And that.
I don't know, this guy's, it almost makes me wonder if his mother even knew he was there, or like, was he like hiding because he was curious and into it? I don't know. But what I can say is it reminds me of that South Park episode with Mr. Garrison when he was upset that his father wouldn't molest him. I don't know if you've ever seen that, but yeah.
And I tried to do the deed when he came to the house. And I guess that's how I got started with the boys at school. I would offer them money, tips from my paper route. Until I got caught.
It sounds like he was already tricking from a very young age.
And then we had to move to Florida because my parents were embarrassed because we have a big family. We're Italian. My mother had 8 sisters and 2 brothers. So I had a lot of nephews and nieces and cousins, and we left. And nothing happened until I ran into this hustler. We were called to Clearwater 28 because all 28 of us were with this one person, and he got picked up for a B&E, and the police knew that he was hustling and he was underage, so that's how we all got connected with that.
But your escapade that you got arrested for, was that one of, were there others that you engaged in that you didn't get caught for?
Many.
How many young boys do you think you had fun with?
Oh no, again.
Well, there's an old saying, as many dicks they were put in me, if they were sticking out, I'd look like a porcupine. That's how many.
And look at his face after he says that, like, no, like, this guy is so lucky that he's out of prison. You know, he didn't get caught for the other ones, and he's complaining about the ones that he legitimately got caught for. Anyways, here we go.
And that's none anymore.
Okay.
The porcupine has died.
Do you have remorse?
He laughs after it, like, okay, anyways, here we go.
Over that behavior, or?
You know,
I mean, you were 6, 7, 8 years old, and you were initiated.
Okay, wait, hold on, I need a minute. Okay. I don't even need to explain that one. Like, fortunately, you know, the statute of limitations thing makes it to where if he has any more victims out there, they should maybe step forward after this, because he's pretty much laughing about the stuff and playing victim for the little bit of time he did have to serve. Anyways.
Dating with older men, I mean.
Right.
I mean, maybe this is a gay culture thing that I don't understand. It sounds.
I don't have any, well, like the judge told me with a 13-year-old, me buying him cigarettes. He was out there. I didn't give him any money. I just did it because he was cute. But he was out there hustling to get money for his mother's addiction. that came out in the hearing. And the judge told me that he wasn't going to charge me any restitution because I paid my restitution in carton of cigarettes.
Really?
But that's the
how did he get away with
youngest
that?
Boy that I went with after I was 30 years old. But between the ages of 13, 14, and 15, they were young kids from school. But that all ended when I turned 21 and could get into gay bars.
What's the most important lesson you've learned?
None.
The important lesson?
Not to get caught. It seems like he'd say.
To love myself better. To mind my own business. I guess it's because I chalk it up as old age. I guess when you get a certain age, you just don't care if you have sex anymore. I don't even masturbate anymore.
That's him. That's not, no.
I just, friends come in and I tell them, hey, since I lived where I'm living now, we moved in January, I'd be a year, I haven't had sex. They'll say, yeah, we know you. But I haven't. So it's
he's just saying this like it's a badge of honor, like something to be proud of.
Just living out my life. I want to say, though, I think about all these, and I remember all of them, and I think about it. It never leaves you. You're always, it's in your mind.
And how are those memories for you? Are they pleasant? Are they painful? Are they, do you have guilt over them? Do you have?
Some guilt, no pleasantry whatsoever, not for what I.
Do you feel like you took advantage of these?
I do. Yeah. And I did. Because at the time they didn't want to. But you work on them like they say that you.
Wait. He just totally contradicted everything he just said before. Before he just said they were these young hustlers who wanted to do it and one he met in a bar and he took them home. Like, and now it's, oh, they didn't want to do this. I pressured him into it and I groomed him. So this interview, he's gotten nothing beneficial out of this that would, like, help people. I know I saw certain people in the comments saying they're watching this because it helps them better understand sex offenders. No, there's nothing productive in this at all. Anyways, yeah.
Find them. So you get them to where they will do it.
So you prayed on them, okay?
Yeah, I feel terrible about the whole situation now that I look back at it all those years. I wasted my life.
Wait, he feels terrible about it because he wasted his life? What about destroying their lives? Maybe he'll say something about that. I doubt it, though.
I didn't make my life better at all. And if there's anybody that does this and is listening to this and seeing this, heed my warning. It's not worth it. It really isn't.
So this is a warning to the guys that want to prey on young boys? It's not, okay, wow.
Because you're scarred for life. That's lame. And thank God my mother's not living.
You and your victim both.
Excuse me?
You and your victim both.
Oh, I apologize to my victim 100 times over. And if I could see him, I would tell him that I am so sorry. But we're not allowed to have any contact with our victims. I wouldn't know where he is anyway.
All right, Frankie. Thank you so much for sharing your story.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you so much.
Dude, I mean, all right. I don't see anything helpful in that interview as far as like better understanding the mind of sex offenders. I've seen way, you know, more informative things than that. I mean, yeah, I still like all of Soft White Underbelly stuff for the most part that I've seen. I mean, some of it's kind of controversial in my opinion. Some of it I thought, you know, he's gone too far, he went too far, or I didn't agree with his approach, and or I maybe have found some of his methods to be a bit exploitive. But in this case, it's like my main issue with this one is the have fun with young boys thing. I think that's pretty disrespectful to the victims. It's not having fun with them, it's, you know, torturing them, it's destroying their lives. You know, and so if he's trying to relate to the guy, he should have posed it like, so how many boys? And just said that and left it open. But anyways, yeah. Definitely check out Soft White Underbelly stuff. Very interesting. Talk to you later. Bye.